Excellent.
Thank you. I kind of look forward to that. So, today I'm going to talk about. Hello, Susan.
Yeah, I think you can draw from. I think all the areas of your specialization are of great interest. You can even draw from financial markets.
Financial markets.
You created a big havoc.
Yes.
And sent to Mr. Lund. And she looks after that. There's a World Bank project. And I met together their financial. And then we have three big conferences. Mr. White and also Secretary Foreign Affairs of the US.
Secretary Kerry?
Kerry, yes. They also did.
Oh, fantastic.
And we have Dr. The chapter contractor, CPA, and PhD, and it's professor in the area of finance and companies law. Professor Mathur, and the PhD from Opinion Management Institute in India, I am Bangalore. He's also head of our innovations department, and he does a lot of work on innovations. And he also works for IT. All regulatory agencies. Mr. Gordon, he is chief editor officer of the institute. So Saitama is the dean and an information scientist and fellow of the Computer Society of India.
Fantastic. Wow, well you have a mix of anthropologists and bankers and CPA. That's very interdisciplinary. So I'm an economist by training. I work at the research arm, the internal think tank of the McKinsey, it's called the McKinsey Global Institute, and it's the research arm of a consulting firm, McKinsey & Company. The Global Institute was founded in 1991, and for the first 10 years of its existence, it did work really on national competitiveness and economic growth and productivity.
We have a commission on competitiveness. One of my colleagues is a member of that. And recently an announcement in our first speech, there will be more of that.
Yeah.
So, Sudhana, Professor Patanjali, and Professor Amish, and the other Professor Patanjali. And we have the Dr. Glynn. He specializes in the field of financial markets.
Okay.
Great.
Well, my own research. So I'm one of the leaders of the Global Institute. I oversee the research agenda, and we're now spread around the world. So we're a virtual institute. We have people in San Francisco, Washington, D.C., London, Zurich, Mumbai, Singapore, and Beijing. And we're going to open hubs in Latin America and Africa this year. So we work in, across borders. My own research has been traditionally in financial markets, international finance, and labor markets and job creation, globalization. Now, since typically, even though I'm American, I live in Washington, D.C., we really didn't study the United States very much because things were growing and there wasn't too much to say. But since 2008, since the financial crisis, there's been a lot of concern about job creation, employment. The country went through a big recession, and there was a realization that even before the crisis, that job creation had been very weak, even though GDP was growing, basically after 2000.
In India, so we had jobless growth.
Exactly. It was really, well, there was job creation, but it's because of the debt that households were taking on. So there was a big boom in construction, so you didn't notice as much that unemployment rates were not very high because there was this credit boom and consumer spending. But now looking back at the data, you can see that outside of the construction sector, job creation was actually very weak, even before the crisis. And now since the crisis, of course, unemployment has gotten very high. So I think I've been asked to share research we did over the last year. So we've done a series of reports on the US economy. We did one on this jobless growth and what's underlying it 2 years ago. And then last year we came back. Now the economy is out of recession. It's been growing, but very slowly. So growth has been between 1 2% this year might be 2.5%, which is very slow. So we think that the long-term potential growth rate of the U.S. economy would be around 3%. And given that we've come out of a very steep recession, you would expect some quarters of 3.5%, even 4% growth. And we just haven't seen that. It's been very weak. So we did research looking into what are the structural factors underlying what's holding back the US economy, and what are opportunities that if the public sector and private sector together invested could really lift growth substantially over the next 10 years and get the US back on a track of more robust growth.
One good thing could be to increase trade and remove all the inheriting sectors.
Yeah.
It does not happen.
Yeah.
And India and US, they can work together on the field of IPRs,
mm-hmm.
patents, R&D,
yeah.
science and technology. Advanced science and technology, and the services sector.
Mm-hmm.
And there, value addition will be too large. And that will fuel the growth. And if America develops, India also develops.
Yeah.
So
well,
there are big. That America should go. I was speaking only the other day to participants who were in a workshop in the European Union.
Mm-hmm.
And we find that both trade, of European Union with India is decreasing.
Yeah.
US and India is not picking up, not because there is no demand, but because there are so many restrictions
mm-hmm.
and policy problems, which exist among these countries.
Yeah.
And we have been trying for an FTA.
Mm-hmm.
So US is going in for an FTA with European Union, but the same kind of FTA should be there between European Union and India also. There
yeah,
is, I
yeah.
think, we have to hit it off,
yeah.
but we are not doing that, and we get bogged down on small issues.
Yeah, I know there is not.
In the financial market, rather, there is so much to do.
Yeah.
So technology is one thing. America can do technology to India. We have a burgeoning financial market here.
Mm-hmm.
He is my colleague, Professor Murthy. He is the deputy dean and an expert in the area of financial markets.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Respected Professor R.K. Mishraji, Director IPE, respected Professor Susan Lund, Partner McKinsey Global Institute, Washington DC, Professor M.L. Sai Kumar, Dean, Professor Nagesh Rao Garu, Distinguished Visiting Faculty and former GM of Andhra Bank, Distinguished Faculty, Student Friends. Today is a great day because we have Professor Susan amongst us, and we have great pleasure in welcoming Madam. And a brief introduction about Professor Susan. Professor Susan Lund is partner of McKinsey & Company at McKinsey Global Institute, the firm's economic research arm. An economist by training, Dr. Lund's areas of expertise include financial markets, labor markets, and country productivity and competitiveness. She lived and worked in Africa and Asia before joining McKinsey and Company. Dr. Lund is a frequent speaker at global conferences on workforce issues and financial markets, and has authored numerous articles in leading business and academic publications, including Foreign Affairs, Harvard Business Review, the Financial Times, the Wall Street Journal, and the Washington Post. Dr. Lund holds a PhD in economics from Stanford University. She now lives in Washington, D.C. I also take this opportunity to welcome Mr. Salil Qadir from U.S. Consulate Office. Let me, before I request our director to address the students, I request my colleague Sai Saleja to hand over a bouquet to Madam. Thank you, Dr. Sai Saleja. Thank you, Madam. Now I request our director to address them.
Professor Murthy, Professor Sai Kumar, Professor Lund, friends, we cannot understand business and economics unless we understand how the US works. And here we have an expert from US, and that too from McKinsey, and a person who holds a PhD from Stanford. So it's a very valuable opportunity, and through her we would know how the US economy functions, what are the problems that the US economy is facing, what is the interrelationship between Indian economy and the US economy. Now US is growing at a rate of 1.5% per annum, and you know, last 10 years its growth declined very sharply, and there was an impact of that on the Indian economy also. Our growth rate also declined from 8.5% to 4%. Again, US economy is having an uptick, and as US economy is growing, India has also started growing. So we can see, if good happens in US, good happens in India. And therefore, we must understand how the US economy functions. I would like to tell you one thing. Now today, India is a $5 trillion economy. That is 2014. By 2030, India will become an economy of $50 trillion. Now, when you are not able to manage your economy today, when it is of a size of $5 trillion, how you are going to do that when you become an economy of $50 trillion? I think we can learn that from US, because US even today, in terms of economy, about 50 times bigger than India. So how does US manage? I think great opportunity for us. I welcome Professor Lund. I also thank Mr. Kedar, who is in the US consulate, who has used his good office in bringing Mrs. Lund. And I have made a request on your behalf to Professor Lund, who is an expert on financial markets, on employment, on skills, to come to IP and take a one credit course where she can give 10 lectures.
Thank you very much. It's an honor to be here with you. It's fantastic to be traveling in India. This is my first time in India. I've spent a lot of time in Southeast Asia and China and Africa, but I never had an opportunity to come here. So I've been having a wonderful week talking to a variety of students, academics, policymakers, and businesses. It's the first time all week I'll be talking about the US economy. So I'd be happy to share with you some perspectives on what has happened to the US economy over the last 5 years and where it could be headed from here. Then we'll take question and answer, and I would love to hear your questions and comments, your perspectives. So the US economy, In 2007 and 8, we had a global financial crisis. It started in the United States. It started with banks lending to what we call subprime borrowers, or borrowers without a lot of income, who were taking out loans that it turns out they couldn't afford. And this was very profitable for the banks, so they lent money, and there was a big credit boom between 2000 and 2007. And eventually, those borrowers started to default on their loans in very large numbers. Now, prior to this, we always thought that housing markets in the US were local, so that if you had house price declines in one place, like Washington, where I live, the market in California would be fine. So if you had exposure across the country, losses, there may be losses in one market as a local economy went through a recession, but the rest of the country would be fine. But for the first time, we discovered that you could have a national house price decline. And this caused tremendous losses for banks. And it turns out that a lot of the European banks and people in other countries had bought securities based on those mortgages, so the losses rippled out to Europe and the rest of the world. The US economy then went into a very steep recession. It was the worst recession since the Great Depression of 1930. We call it the Great Recession. GDP fell by about 5%. Millions of people lost their jobs, and the economic pain has been very real. Now, since that time, the economy started to recover in 2009, and GDP started growing. But we've had what we call at the McKinsey Global Institute a jobless recovery. We've had GDP growth, but very little job creation. So when we went back and looked at all the US recessions since World War II, we found an interesting pattern. Traditionally, it took about 6 months into a recovery for job creation to return. And then in 1990, suddenly that pattern was broken, and it took 15 months before job creation returned to the pre-recession level of jobs. And then in the 2000 recession, it took 30 months.